Time Warner Audiobooks presents Gossip Girl, written by Cecily von Ziegesar and read by Christina Ricci, with gossip read by Maria DeLuca. Hey people, ever wondered what the lives of the chosen ones are really like? Well, I'm going to tell you, because I'm one of them. I'm not talking about beautiful models, or actors, or musical prodigies, or mathematical geniuses. I'm talking about the people who are born to it. Those of us who have everything anyone could possibly wish for, and who take it all completely for granted. Welcome to New York City's Upper East Side, where my friends and I live and go to school and play and sleep, sometimes with each other. We all live in huge apartments with our own bedrooms and bathrooms and phone lines. We have unlimited access to money and booze and whatever else we want. And our parents are rarely home, so we have tons of privacy. We're smart, we've inherited classic good looks. We wear fantastic clothes and we know how to party. Our shit still stinks, but you can't smell it because the bathroom is sprayed hourly by the maid with a refreshing scent made exclusively for us by French perfumeries. It's a luxe life, but someone's gotta live it. Our apartments are all within walking distance of the Metropolitan Museum of Art on Fifth Avenue, and the single-sex private schools, like Constance Billard, which most of us go to. Even with a hangover, Fifth Avenue always looks so beautiful in the morning with the sunlight glimmering on the heads of the sexy St. Jude schoolboys. But something is rotten on Museum Mile. The girl who leaves for boarding school gets kicked out and comes back. Yes, Serena is back from boarding school. Her hair is longer, paler. Her blue eyes have that deep mysteriousness of kept secrets. While we are all dying to ask her why she got kicked out of boarding school, we won't, because we'd really rather she had stayed away. But Serena is definitely here. If we aren't careful, Serena is going to win over our teachers, wear that dress we couldn't fit into, eat the last olive, have sex in our parents' beds, spill Campari on our rugs, steal our brothers' and our boyfriends' hearts, and basically ruin our lives and piss us off in a major way. I'll be watching closely. I'll be watching all of us. It's going to be a wild and wicked year. I can smell it. Love, Gossip Girl. Like most juicy stories, it started at a party. Blair Waldorf tucked her long, dark brown hair behind her ears and swigged vintage scotch from the crystal tumbler in her hand. The point is, I was trapped in my room all morning because they were busy having a gross romantic breakfast in their matching red silk bathrobes. Blair took another gulp of her drink. The only way to tolerate the thought of her mother sleeping with that man was to get drunk, very drunk. Luckily, Blair and her friends came from the kind of Manhattan families for whom drinking was as commonplace as blowing your nose. Their parents believed in the quasi-European idea that the more access kids have to alcohol, the less likely they are to abuse it. So Blair and her friends could drink whatever they wanted, whenever they wanted, as long as they maintained their grades and their looks and didn't embarrass themselves or their family. The man Blair was so upset about was Cyrus Rose, her mother's new boyfriend. At that very moment, Cyrus Rose was standing on the other side of the living room, greeting the dinner guests. He looked like someone who might help you pick out shoes at Saks, bald, except for a small bushy mustache, his fat stomach barely hidden in a shiny blue double-breasted suit. He had a loud laugh and was very sweet to Blair's mother, but he wasn't Blair's father. Last year, Blair's father ran off to France with another man. But tonight, Blair was going to have to tolerate Cyrus Rose, because the dinner party her mother was giving was in his honor, and all the Waldorf's family friends were there to meet him. The only ones still missing were Mr. and Mrs. Vander Woodsen, whose teenage daughter Serena and son Eric were both away at school. Blair's mother was famous for her dinner parties, and this was her first since her infamous divorce. The Waldorf's penthouse had been expensively redecorated that summer, and in the center of the dining room table was an enormous silver bowl full of white orchids. Gold leaf place cards lay on every porcelain plate. "You and Blair have been going out a long time, am I right?" Cyrus said, punching Blair's boyfriend, Nate Archibald, in the arm. "You sleep with her yet?"
Nate turned redder than the upholstery on the French chaise next to him. Well, we've known each other practically since we were born, he stuttered, but we've only been going out for, like, a year. We don't want to ruin it by, you know, rushing. What was he supposed to say? Dude, if I had my way, we'd be doing it right now? Nate was one of those boys you look at, and while you're looking at them, you know they're thinking, that girl can take her eyes off me because I'm so hot. Although he didn't act at all conceited about it. He couldn't help looking hot. He was just born that way. Poor guy. That night, Nate was wearing the moss-green cashmere V-neck sweater Blair had given him last Easter, when her father had taken them skiing in Sun Valley. Secretly, Blair had sewn a tiny gold heart pendant onto the inside of one of the sweater's sleeves. Blair liked to think of herself as a hopeless romantic, in the style of old movie actresses like Audrey Hepburn. She was always coming up with plot devices for the movie she was starring in at the moment. The movie that was her life. I love you, Blair had told Nate breathily when she gave him the sweater. Me too, Nate had said back, although he wasn't exactly sure if it was true or not. When he put the sweater on, it looked so good on him that Blair wanted to scream and rip all her clothes off. But Blair had wanted to wait to have sex until her 17th birthday next month. But now she was through with waiting. Nate was looking better than ever. The moss-green sweater had turned his eyes a dark, sparkling green, and his wavy brown hair was streaked with golden blonde from his summer on the ocean. And just like that, Blair knew she was ready. She took another sip of her scotch. Oh yes, she was definitely ready. The room was abuzz with snatches of gossip about Blair's mother and Cyrus Rose. From what Blair could hear, her mother's friends felt exactly the same way she did, although they didn't exactly use words like annoying, fat, or loser. I smell Old Spice, Mrs. Coates whispered to Mrs. Archibald. Do you think he's actually wearing Old Spice? I'm not sure, Mrs. Archibald whispered back, but I think he might be. All these people were terrible gossips. Across the room, Cyrus grabbed Eleanor and kissed her on the lips in full view of everyone. Blair shrank away from the revolting sight and headed towards Nate. I have to talk to you, Blair said. She held out her glass. Fill me up first. Nate took her glass, and Blair led him over to the marble-topped wet bar by the French doors that opened onto the dining room. Nate poured them each a tumbler full of scotch, and then followed Blair across the living room once more. Hey, where are you two going? Chuck Bass asked, leering at them suggestively. Blair rolled her eyes at Chuck and kept walking, drinking as she went. Nate followed her, ignoring Chuck completely. Chuck Bass, the oldest son of Misty and Bartholomew Bass, was handsome, aftershave commercial handsome. Chuck was also the horniest boy in Blair and Nate's group of friends. Once at a party in ninth grade, Chuck had hidden in a guest bedroom closet for 2 hours, waiting to crawl into bed with Katie Farkas, who was so drunk she kept throwing up in her sleep. In other circles, Chuck might have been banished as a slime ball of the highest order, but these families had been friends for generations. They had gotten used to his gold monogrammed pinky ring, and even his trademark navy blue monogrammed cashmere scarf. Don't forget to use protection, Chuck called as Blair and Nate turned down the long red carpeted hallway to Blair's bedroom. At that moment, Nate's hopes perked up. Blair was acting sort of sultry and sexy, and could it be? Something was about to happen. Blair squeezed Nate's hand and pulled him into the room. They stumbled over each other, falling toward the bed, and spilling their drinks on the mohair rug. Blair giggled. The scotch she'd pounded had gone right to her head. I'm about to have sex with Nate, she thought giddily. And then they'd both graduate in June and go to Yale in the fall and have a huge wedding 4 years later and find a beautiful apartment on Park Avenue and have sex in every room on a rotating basis. Suddenly, Blair's mother's voice rang out loud and clear down the hallway. Serena van der Woodsen? What a lovely surprise. Nate dropped Blair's hand and straightened up like a soldier called to attention. Blair sat down hard on the end of her bed and grasped the bedspread in tight, white-knuckled fists. She looked up at Nate. But Nate was already turning to go, striding back down the hall to see if it could possibly be true. Had Serena van der Woodsen really come back? The movie of Blair's life had taken a sudden, tragic turn. In the foyer, Serena pushed a stray blonde hair behind her ear and smiled. When Serena smiled, she used her eyes. those dark, almost navy blue.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.